We're going to do the final stage. We're going to end up with the self-compiling compiler. Well, in the previous video, what we did was we developed a C compiler by writing it in assembler, hypothetically anyway. And the net result of that is you get a working C compiler that works on the particular chipset that's in your computer. It could be ARM, it could be Intel, it could be whatever. And it does what you expect it to do. It drinks in C program statements and it spits out at the other end through its code generator modules a binary which, when suitably packaged, will become an executable on your particular piece of machinery. Traditionally under Unix and Linux, these are called a.out files. Traditionally under Windows, they're called .exes, aren't they? But it's basically something that is very, very close to a loadable, runnable binary as translation of your C program. And we left it last time. If you like, you could say this is our C compiler, but we could almost call it the Mark I, because we're saying hypothetically we developed it via an assembler route. So when it executes, it's running assembler quality binary, and it's also producing, shall we say, assembler quality binary. I'll label that compiler Mark I. So you say, well, what's wrong with that? Why not just stick like that? We've got a compiler that works. Well, it could be a variety of reasons. It could be that although it's running binary of quality A, that binary could be not very good. It could be slow. It could be a perfectly good compiler, but it seems to take forever. Yeah? That will be one good reason for doing it. There might just possibly, now you hope not, be a very, very hidden bug that for certain C inputs, it just crashes. You hope that testing and debugging have removed all those, but you can never be sure. So there's maybe another reason that certain sorts of constructs sometimes cause it to crash. You don't want that. But what you're now saying is, can we use a not top quality thing to make a better instance of itself? Now, this is not a new idea. Some of the commenters on my previous video have been pointing out the machine tool industry has been doing this for ages, using a not very good tool that's on its last legs as a means of making something that's sharper and better. You can imagine a 3D printer that has been produced in a component-wise way by other 3D printers. And there is a vital cog in the middle of it, which turns around a lot for some reason or another and gets worn. And what you'd like to do is to improve the quality of that vital cog. You're worried that it's going to split apart and do it. So why not program your machine to make that vital cog on the machine as it now is and just hope it withstands the stress until the piece is made? And then when the piece is made, it's got better tolerances and so on, hopefully, than the bit it's replacing. So you take the bad piece out, throw it away, and put the new one in. So you're actually feeding back into the machine itself a new instance of something that is vital to its running. So even out there in the everyday world, this business of eating yourself and producing a better version of yourself has been around for a long time. And we're going to do something very similar here. What I'm saying is, ideally, I'd like to make bin A be history and a thing of the past, because I'd like to write a new version of the compiler, which we will call Mark II. So just to summarise, this is a compiler running binary code of quality A at the moment and code generating binary of a similar sort of quality. We now write a new version of the C compiler, still written in C, which produces better quality binary. We pay a lot of attention to the code generation modules. So we'll call it bin B. Version 1 is A, version 2 is B, or you can think of the B meaning better, best quality in some sense binary. So that is what you initially write. You write a new version of the C compiler, which takes in C, it produces bin B. You've spent a lot of time on that code generation modules. And of course, at this stage, you think of it as being written in C, which it is. You're writing a new C compiler in C. But the burning question then comes, well, I can't execute C directly on the hardware. I don't have a C interpreter, although in principle I suppose you could develop one. No, that C has got to be turned into binary. How do you turn that C that is written in into binary when you are in the process of constructing the new thing? And the answer is revert to the previous generation, revert to the one that you've hoping to leave behind as a means of propelling you forward as part of the bootstrap process. What we're now saying is we do it like this. We write C producing bin B, the new version of the compiler written in C. How do we compile that C? We have already got the old Mark I version of the compiler, which you'll remember from the top of the previous sheet, takes in C, runs on bin A, executes bin A, let's hope it doesn't fall over, and squirts out binary of quality A. But that's sufficient to show C going in there, whirring around, producing bin A. You've now got an executable, which takes in C, produces much better binary of quality B. Its only weakness is that it's still running itself on binary A. Maybe it's still slow. Maybe binary A is congenitally slow. It's not being very well written at all, but at least it works. Is there some final step? Yes, there is, that would get rid of any vestigial remains of bin A in all of this process cycle. Yeah, that is exactly what you do next. We've got a new version of the C compiler, but its executable is only still of bin A quality. How to improve it? Feed the new version of the compiler to the executable that you have just created, and it would go like this. Look, here's your new Mark II version of the C compiler. C compiler written in C producing bin B. Feed it through the previous thing that we developed at the end of the previous sheet. What we ended up with, if you remember, is a version of the compiler now that can do C to bin B, so it's a new version. The only little weakness inside it is it's running bin A. But can you see that by feeding that into a binary executable of itself, what you do is you feed your C in. This is running on bin A, but it spits out bin B. So what you collect in your .exe or .a.out file at the end is what you want. C producing bin B, but running on bin B. So this is now our executable for the new version. But the beautiful thing about it is that that remaining weakness here, where you use the old version, running bin A, to produce a version that doesn't have bin A in it at all, final stage, feed that back to itself. Da-da! Sound of trumpets. C, written in C, producing bin B. But as a result of the previous exercise, we've now got a version of the compiler that is the binary instantiation of this. We have got from over here a C producing bin B, written in bin B. Well, use it. Use it to recompile yourself. And you end up now with C written in bin B, producing bin B. Any memories of the hell you went through with the assembler version can now be forgotten. You can throw that away and carefully, of course, store away your version now, which only needs to get back to a bin B level of history in order to regenerate itself. And I suppose you could say, therefore, that this triumphant thing, which I put three stars on here, the product we were trying for all along, you can say it's now a self-sufficient compiler, as well as being a self-compiling compiler. It only needs a working and debugged version of itself in order to be a wondrous new replacement. Now, things are never quite that perfect. There's always a downside.
I've got a question, because you kind of sort of alluded to it there. I skipped over it nicely, but debugged, right? Yes. I mean, what happens if there are problems with this? Where do we go with it?
You always have to retain the ability to go back further than you would wish. Of course you do. I think it is fair to say that compiling a C compiler is a very heavy and demanding task for a C compiler to do. You would get varieties of code, usages of data structures and all sorts in a compiler that you will not lightly find in a weather forecasting program, let alone an events listing, date, calendar, whatever. A compiler is a demanding thing to write. It is going to be a demanding thing to compile. It may well be that just saying, oh, feed it to the old compiler, that the old compiler just falls over when faced with the unbelievable quality of the C you've written for the Mark II thing. So yes, that always happens. You can feed it to itself and then itself falls over. What do you do? Well, you've got to back off and do it again. But you can see that in the end, it is the way to go. Get yourself, use the whole idea of feeding something to itself to, how shall we say, motivate the quality of the C that you write to be compilable, and giving a mind, of course, to efficiency and so on all the way along the chain. But I do hope that this example, for those of you who maybe been a bit puzzled, saying, what is all this bootstrapping? One of the problems, I think, is that even sometimes when you see T-diagram explanations, they make it hard by not distinguishing, if you like, between bin A and bin B. I've seen explanations which just write bin and don't make it clear that it's a different sort of binary, you know, and that, I think, causes a lot of confusion. So I hope this has helped.
Is it possible that this goes through oodles more, that's a technical term, oodles more iterations? So you've got bin C, bin D, bin E.
Oh, yeah. Yes. Yes, if you decide that, well, bin B was fine for its time, but frankly, there's a whizzy new idea with interlocked triple ref pointers pointing to data structures that do this, that, and the other, and that's absolutely the way to write the next version of the C compiler, then you can do exactly the same thing. You'd be daft not to use the previous version of the compiler to compile yourself. But what you must be careful of is that if you're in the process of, as it were, defining the subset of the language that the C compiler compiles, you hope it will be total, but there may be glitches in it. You've got to try and write C that is capable of compiling itself, and you've got that in your mind all the time when you're doing this.
So it's its own worst case scenario, right?
Yes, exactly. Yes, yes. I'm a fabulous compiler, but please don't feed me with myself. All hell may break loose. Yeah, yeah.
Event the key up. Mouse click events. We probably wouldn't get one when the mouse is moved. If you think about it, as the mouse is being moved, you'll get lots and lots of events, most of which you're not interested in. You're probably only interested when a button's pressed or so on. The only times perhaps that's different is if perhaps you're dragging something around the screen.